Unit 2 actually deals with the different approximate methods that we come across in quantum mechanics. Though there are other topics, other methods available in quantum mechanics, primarily dealing with the particle physics, high energy particle physics of subatomic or subnuclear physics. But this technique which we are using today, or which we will be discussing in this lecture series, is mainly focuses on the atomic and molecular spectroscopy. So I try to develop this topic, I try to discuss things helpful for experimental physicists who those are working on a spectroscopic side. So it's not that just the quantum mechanics is helpful for theoretical point of view, its implication, its understanding is also required and mandatory for experimental physicists. So my aim is to go with this background, that how this concepts of different approximate methods which are useful in solving the problems in quantum mechanics is also useful in dealing with the experimental side. This unit number 2, which I have listed here, is also divided into two parts, two topics, two techniques which we will be considering. First is the time independent perturbation theory. So this topic which we will be considering here can be divided also whether you want to involve the time in your problem or not. So the techniques which we will be focusing in the first two part, that is the time independent perturbation theory and the variational technique, they both are dealing with the stationary states where time is not important. So and later on, even the next method like a WKB method, that is also dealing with the time independent case. As a special case of a time dependent perturbation theory, we have a separate part, separate unit. So that I will discuss later on. So first and the foremost is that in this topic, in this lecture, we will be focusing only on the problem which is not depending on time, or you are working on a time domain where the change in the system with respect to time is negligible. So let us say you are focusing on some system, you want to study that system, and if for a given period of time system does not change, then you say that it is independent of time. Of course, on a larger time scale it may change, but for the time period of your interest, if system is remaining constant, is not changing with the time, then this method can be useful. So I start with this idea, and let us first focus on the time independent perturbation theory. But before we go to the topic of time perturbation theory, we should also realize that why such approximate methods are useful, or why such approximate methods are actually required. To summarize this question, in this first slide I try to mention that there are only few, in fact I try to list four of them, only few problems which are exactly solvable, right? To some of you are already known to this problems, like we have simple harmonic oscillator problem, which we in unit number 1 we have solved completely, either using the matrix mechanics or using the wave mechanics. We have another problem in quantum mechanics, that is a particle in a box, that also we have solved completely using the equations and using the second order linear differential equations. Or if you have a particle in a potential well, maybe the square well, that is also exactly solvable problem, or even a hydrogen atom problem, which we have also discussed in unit 1. So these are only few problems in quantum mechanics which are exactly solvable. So what do we mean by exactly solvable and approximately solvable problem? Whenever you say exactly solvable problem, means you will not resort on any kind of approximation, you will not involve any approximations, and simply by doing the mathematics, following certain rules of mathematics, you can solve the problems. We have already realized that in a wave mechanics or in the quantum mechanics that we have studied up till, mostly all the operators, whether it's an energy operator, whether it's a momentum operator, whether it's an angular momentum operator, all of them were written in the form of a differentiation. They were differential operators. And therefore, whenever we try to solve this set of problems, particle in a box or simple harmonic oscillator or hydrogen atom problem, all of them, when we try to solve, then we come across a mathematics of differentiation, because operators themselves are differential operators, and therefore the mathematics will be of differentiation. And when you solve this problem in three dimension, having say x, y, z coordinates or r, theta, phi coordinates, then we have a differentiation with respect to all coordinates, and therefore in general these problems are partially differential equations. So we need to solve such a differential equations with respect to x coordinate, with respect to y coordinate, or even with respect to z coordinate. So we have a partial differential equations, and we also know that the highest order of differentiation that we come across either in hydrogen atom problem or simple harmonic oscillator problem is second order. So summarizing all of them, we are doing a mathematics of second order linear differential equations. And the purpose of solving this linear differential equations with a dimensionless quantity is that we can have a ready-made solutions available in the mathematics for such a second order linear differential equation. So without actually solving the problems, we can directly take the ready-made solutions available in the maths, and we can compare our results with the experimental physics, experimental results. So this all four problems, or such a limited number of problems, were exactly solvable. We do not employ any approximations. Of course, we put some conditions on it, because as we know, in the example of hydrogen atom, when you construct the hydrogen atom, that is, electron is in a vicinity of the nucleus, it is in a Bohr radius, then electron is moving. So the possibility of finding the electron should be very large at this distance. You cannot expect electron to be found at an infinite distance. So the condition which we have imposed is that the finding the of electron at infinite distance should be zero. So this is one admissible condition, that if your electron cannot be found at a large distance. Similarly, if we go to the nucleus, if you go to the center of the problem, then the electron cannot be found even at the nucleus. So these are physically imposed conditions. They are not approximations. This we call as an admissible condition. So we select our state function, we select our wave function following certain admissible, physically allowed conditions, but they are not approximations, mind well. So these four problems are likewise such a few, only few problems which can be solved exactly. But remaining all the problems that we come across in physics, they are not exactly solvable, and therefore one needs to go for the methods which are approximate methods. You put some, you employ some approximations, and within the purview of this approximation, within the limitations of this approximations, we can solve the problem. Right? So this entire unit number 2 and unit number 3 actually deals with such approximate methods. As I said, in unit 2, we are learning in fact two techniques, time independent perturbation technique, and second is known as a variation technique. Whereas in unit number 3, we will be talking about WKB approximations, and later on about the time dependent perturbation theory. But let us focus on this unit number 2, where first part is dealing with this time independent perturbation theory. This method, time independent perturbation technique, is also known as a stationary perturbation theory. Stationary because the state or the energy states which we are calculating in this technique, that will not change with time. Your Hamiltonian is independent of time. So the very first assumption which we make in this technique is that the total Hamiltonian is independent of time. And if Hamiltonian is independent of time, and you know that Hamiltonian represents the total energy for a conservative system, so correspondingly, the energy states that we will calculate will also be independent of time. In the language of, say, spectroscopy, we say that energy states are stationary. So this technique is for the time independent problem, where Hamiltonian is now not depending on time. This technique, which is named as a stationary perturbation theory, this perturbation means, the dictionary meaning of the perturbation means, you are slightly changing or you are slightly disturbing your system from its equilibrium or from its unperturbed condition. So how this has been useful, how this actually been helping the experimental physicist? We know in experimental physicists, whatever observation you make, whatever calculations you do, whatever thing you perform in experiments, you need some agency. For example, if you want to study, let us say, the spectra of hydrogen atom, right, then you can apply from outside electric field and you put your hydrogen atom in presence of electric field. And you know that this is a very famous experiment which you are already studying, is known as a Stark effect. So in the case of Stark effect, the idea is that we use electromagnetic radiation to study, to probe, to understand how the different energy states are in the hydrogen atom. Not only the electric field, even you can employ magnetic field. Then you know that the very famous experiment known as a Zeeman effect. So here, basically, either in Stark effect or in a Zeeman effect, what we do, whatever system you have, quantum mechanical system you have, we try to perturb, we try to use some external agencies like electric field or magnetic field to understand further about the system. So in all the experiments, in quantum mechanics point of view, we actually disturb the system. The system which you want to investigate, the system you want to understand, that has been exposed, that has been applied by some external field. It can be even temperature also. You heat the system to understand something. You pressurize the system to understand certain things. So these external parameters like temperature, pressure, or you apply electric field or magnetic field, they actually disturb the system. They actually perturb the system. So all the experiments which we are performing, the basic idea is that we actually perturb the system in order to investigate the system. So this theory which we are using, it is very much helpful to all the experimental physicists who want to take reading, who want to take some observations about the system. Having said that, we should also be clear about the meaning of perturbation. As I have already written here, the perturbation means it's a slight disturbance. So you cannot expect the change in the system to be very large. So for example, who those are working with, say, laser, and laser being a very powerful radiation, you cannot consider the system which is exposed to the laser as a slightly perturbed system, because laser being so powerful, it is so intense that it will not make the changes very minutely. In fact, it will change the system drastically, and therefore, whenever you have a external agencies like a laser beam, which is so powerful that actually changes the thing on a larger scale, it will disturb the systems on a larger scale, that cannot be considered as a perturbation. And therefore, whenever you are dealing with a system with a large or intense external field, this technique, the perturbation technique which we are learning, is not applicable. So in a way, this is the another, you can say, a limitation of this perturbation technique which we are learning, that you can use this technique only for a case when your system is only minutely or slightly disturbed from its original or from its equilibrium condition. Once you are identified that this external agency is minute, it is a small, it is making a small change in the system, then in this technique, we make another assumption that the total Hamiltonian can be splitted, can be divided into two parts. One part which is corresponding to one of the exactly solvable problems. Don't forget, as in this slide I have mentioned, there are three or four problems which are exactly solvable. And all of these four problems are very useful in constructing, in designing, or in developing this perturbation theory. So what we are making here, that the total Hamiltonian is now divided into two parts. You can write the total Hamiltonian as a sum of the unperturbed part and the perturbed part. perturbed part, as I've said, it is just a small change. It is just a small modification, but largely, majorly, it is this unperturbed part which will take care of the Hamiltonian. And you know already that this unperturbed part is an exactly solvable part, and therefore its solution, its eigenvalue will be available. So this is the second assumption which we put here in this stationary perturbation theory. First, that is, the Hamiltonian is time independent, and therefore the energy states are stationary. Second assumption is that your total Hamiltonian can be divided into two parts. One, that is unperturbed part, and second is the perturbed part. So this, if I put it in a reverse way, then I can also say that whenever you have a situation where total Hamiltonian cannot be decoupled, cannot be separated into unperturbed and perturbed part, this theory is not valid. Because this theory demands that your Hamiltonian should be written as a two parts, as a sum of two parts, unperturbed and perturbed. So if your problem does not allow it to separate this unperturbed and perturbed part, then again, this theory will not be useful. So this assumption has its own limitation, that you cannot deal with a problem where Hamiltonian cannot be splitted into perturbed and unperturbed part. Third restriction, third assumption which we are making, that all the energy states which we are learning or we try to understand using this stationary perturbation theory are discrete states. So there is a difference of energy between the consecutive energy levels. It's not the continuous energy levels. For continuous energy levels, we have a separate theory which we will learn in the unit number 4, that is covered in the theory of scattering. So that scattering theory actually deals with those energy states which are continuous in nature. The difference between two successive energy states is zero, and they are falling in a continuum part. But the perturbation theory which we are learning, focusing now, is dealing with a case where energy states are discrete. So with these three assumptions, we are now developing a theory. And as we have done in the unit number 1 also, that we first develop a theory once our mathematical formalism is ready, and then we apply this theory to solve some problem. So these are the three assumptions. Let me just summarize rapidly. Your Hamiltonian is time independent. Your Hamiltonian can be splitted into two parts, perturbed and unperturbed. And energy eigenstates which we are looking for, they are discrete, right? So with this assumption, we can now develop the theory. The first and the foremost part of this theory, as I have already said, that total Hamiltonian, which is now written as a sum of unperturbed part and the perturbed part of the Hamiltonian, then out of this, unperturbed Hamiltonian is exactly solvable problem. And therefore, if I just write the first line, you can see this unperturbed part of the Hamiltonian, which I will write as H0. And obviously, this cat, this caret or this hat indicates it's an abstract operator. And here I'm using this Bray and cat notations, which we have learned in unit number 1. So H0, when operates on U and cat, U and R are the eigenfunctions, eigenstate, or now I can say even eigenvector of this unperturbed Hamiltonian, then it is exactly solvable eigenvalue problem, that is H0UN is equal to ENUN, where EN are the energy eigenvalues and UN, cat UN, are the energy eigenstates of this unperturbed Hamiltonian. And we know that this UN, this cat UN, they follow the orthogonality condition. So beside the below this, I also mentioned that the Bray UM, cat UN, that actually gives you the Kronecker delta MN. And therefore, this cat UN actually forms the complete orthonormal set. And we also know that this complete orthonormal set can be used as a basis. Correct? So whenever we require to expand any state function, then this UN can be taken as the basis, and as a linear combination of this UN, we can expand the other state. So this we can consider as the basis for our problem. Once you know what are EN, what are the energy eigenvalues, once you know what are the state function, eigenstate function UN, then based on this UN and EN, we can develop the perturbation theory. Right? As we have already said in the second assumption here, you can see that the total H, the total Hamiltonian, is written as a sum of unperturbed and perturbed part. So here in this box, you can see the total Hamiltonian H is written as a sum of H0, that is unperturbed part, and H dash, that we call as the perturbed part of the Hamiltonian. So total Hamiltonian is now written as a sum of these two. This is the sign convention we use. H0, this 0 indicates unperturbed part, whereas H prime or H dash, that we reserve for showing the perturbed part. Now, as your Hamiltonian is changed, it is no longer H0, but H0 plus something, correct? And because of this addition of the perturbed part, your total state function will also be no longer UN. Instead of UN, now let us say your new eigen function will be V. So here again, I'm keeping certain sign convention. Whenever I write UN, this small u symbol is reserved for the unperturbed eigenstate, whereas this small v, this symbol I reserve for the total. Total means unperturbed plus perturbed part. So instead of the first equation H0UN equals to ENUN, now my new eigen value problem is that HV equals to WV, where instead of energy E, now the new eigenvalue or the total eigenvalue will be written as W. So this last box actually is the problem which we are solving, that HV is equals to WV. And obviously solving this problem means you are interested in finding what is the value of W and what is the eigenstate V, right? So this is just the formula which we will be now exploring, which we will be now actually solving and trying to find what is the total eigenvalue W and what is the total eigenstate V in terms of the original energy En and original eigenstate UN. That's the idea that we try to use. Okay. To solve this problem, this basically the last equation is also known as the eigenvalue problem, something like HV is equals to WV. Right? So this V is received back, recovered back, so it is eigenstate, and this W is known as the eigenvalue of this total Hamiltonian, and this total Hamiltonian is written as H0 plus H dash. To solve this eigenvalue problem, Lord Rayleigh and Schrödinger, they have developed a theory. What they have done, that for such a discrete energy states, this total Hamiltonian, which is the part sum of the unperturbed part and the perturbed part, there they have introduced the one parameter lambda. Right? So total Hamiltonian will be now written as H0 plus lambda H prime or H dash. By name, this lambda actually determines the strength of the H dash. It is quite obvious that if I take lambda equals to 0, then there is no contribution from the perturbed part. If I take lambda equals to 1, then it says that this H0 plus H dash means the perturbed part or the H prime is now fully involved. For example, if I take lambda is equal to 0.5, that means only 50% of the perturbation is being taken care in the total Hamiltonian. So this lambda, which ranges between 0 and 1, determines that how much is the strength of the perturbation. This H prime term, by what amount you want to include, 30%, 70%, 100%, 0%, that is being taken care of by the factor lambda. So basically this lambda determines the amount of perturbation that we want to include in our description in our mathematics. But of course, finally, our goal is always to write H as equal to H0 plus H dash. So in the last step, whenever we do all this calculation, in the final step, we will put again lambda equals to 1. So as such, there is no change, but just to develop the mathematics, just to develop a mathematical formula, we write h as a h0 plus lambda h dash. We also know that h dash is the slight perturbation. And if it is a slight perturbation, that means compared to the value of h0, the contribution of h dash is very small. So it is something like h0 is a very large contribution. Predominantly, your Hamiltonian is governed by this h0 term. And there is a small shift, there is a small change that is introduced by the h dash. So the value of h dash, magnitude of h dash compared to h0 is very small. If I write something like a 1 plus x, and if x is very much smaller than 1, then this 1 plus x can be expanded as a series. So that is the concept used by Rayleigh and Schrodinger, that since your h dash is very small compared to h0, we can consider this as a small term, and we can now employ the power series for this v, the eigencat v, and the eigenvalue w in terms of this lambda. So what Rayleigh and Schrodinger has proposed while solving this equation, don't forget this last box is our basic equation. This is the equation which we are solving. There this w, which is the eigenvalue, this cat v, that is the eigenstate, that eigenstate and eigenvalue are written as a series in terms of this lambda. You can see this w is written as a series. There are infinite number of terms, lambda raised to n, and multiplied by w raised to n, but in a bracket. Similarly, the state, eigenstate, is also written in the similar fashion. So what Rayleigh and Schrodinger has proposed, that since your h dash is small, we can always write your eigencat v and your eigenvalue w as a series, power series of lambda. But here, just be slightly careful, because in this expression, I have written lambda raised to n. So here, this superscript n, but without bracket, indicates the power. Something like if n is 2, you say it is lambda square. If n is 3, you say it is lambda cube term. But whenever this superscript is written with a bracket, like I have written here as a superscript of w, then this bracketed value indicates the order. So for example, if you write w and n equals to 1, then w raised to 1 means it is the first order term for w. When I say n equals to 2, means you will say it is the second order term. What do you mean by term, or what do you mean by the order? Order means how many times this lambda h dash term is being used, or it is being employed. If you employ lambda h dash term one time, means you are calculating the term up to first order. If you are employing lambda h dash term two times, you apply h dash one time, then again for the second time, then you calculate the physical quantity for second order. So basically, this bracketed value indicates that how many times this lambda h dash term is involved, how many times this lambda h dash operator operates in the equation. Correct? So basically, there is a difference without bracket, it's just the ordinary power, but with a bracket means it is showing the order of term, which is the number of times this lambda h dash term is involved. Correct? Same way for the state eigenstate function v also, lambda raised to n, here n on a lambda is just the number power, whereas for this v in a bracket is the you can see the order of it. So idea is simple, that you can write this small v and w as a power series in terms of lambda. And now if I put all this information, instead of this w here in this box, I use this equation, instead of this v here, if I use this equation, then what will be my equation that I try to write? So this hv is equal to wv. This eigenvalue equation, now I try to write with a power expansion of w and power expansion of this state function v, that is what is written here. Correct? And then, as I have already mentioned, that finally we need to introduce your lambda as a one, because we want all the part, all the contribution from the HDES to be included. So as here I have said, whole lambda you can vary from 0 to 1, but eventually, finally, we will take lambda equals to 1. So here what I do, I take the different values of n. When I say n equals to 0, so it is a zeroth order term. When I say n equals to 1, so lambda raised to 1 means I will say it is a first power term. When I say n equals to 2, lambda raised to 2 means I can say it is a second order term or the second power term. Likewise, if I just open up this bracket, and then if I take lambda equals to 1, I can now collect all the terms with 0 power. I can collect all the terms with the first order or the first power and second power like this. And based on that, I have now collected the different terms. So when I collect only the zeroth power term, then you can see this H0, lambda raised to 0, V0. So left side, we have H0, V0. That is what I have written. On other side, lambda 0 and here, W0 and V0. That is what I have written. HDES term I have not taken because HDES is the small perturbation. Means it is already a first order term. It is already having a small change. And therefore, this HDES term I can consider always of first order in nature. When HDES itself is first order, so first order term multiplied by zero order term gives the first order term. First order term when multiplies to another first order term, that gives something like second order term. I just try to explain this with a numerical number. Let us say your H0 is something like 10, 1010, and your HDES is like 0.1. Then you know that compared to 10, 0.1 can be negligible. So you can definitely write as a series expansion of this term. But when 0.1 multiplies to 0.1, that is a first order multiplied to first order, your answer will be even smaller. It will not be 0.1, it will be 0.01. So when two first order term multiplies, it gives the second order term. Similarly, if I multiply 10 and 0.1, then you know that it is still higher than the first order, but smaller than the H0. So you can consider it as a first order term. It's one only. 10 multiplied by 0.1 means it's one, quite smaller than 10. And therefore, zero order multiplied by first order, result is a first order. First order multiplied by first order, result is second order. First order multiplied by second order, that will give you the third order term. So this is the concept I have used in writing all these equations. So let me go back to my first equation again. With this idea, H0, zero order term, lambda raised to n, if n is 0, so 0 order, then H0, V0 is the 0 order multiplied by 0 order, so it is a 0 order term. On the right side, n or n dash is 0, then W0 and V0, that is also 0 order term, so we have this. But now you can see I have not included this part, H dash and Vn, because H dash is already a first order term, and therefore, even when this first order term multiplies to the zero order term V0, still my answer will be first order. And therefore, I'm not writing it in the first equation. So when I write only zero order term, zeroth power term, then it will be this H0 and V0 on right hand side, W0 and V0 will contribute. Lambda is anyway, it is one. With this idea, when I go to the first order term, then H0 is 0 order. So this V cannot be 0 order. Otherwise, you know that 0 order multiplied by 0 order gives 0 order. You want now first order. So H0, if it is 0 order, then here the contribution from this part should be first order. So you can see H0 and V1 that comes. Second, now H dash, which is already first order. So I cannot take this as the first order. Otherwise, first order and first order will make it second order. So H dash will not go as with V1. H dash will go only with V0 because first order multiplied by V0, zero order, that finally gives me the first order term. You can see this left side in the first order term has a contribution like H0, V1, and H dash and V0. Likewise, you can understand the second term. Second order will give accordingly the different equations. So all these equations 1, 2, 3 are actually written for the different order terms, written as a different power of lambda. And finally, I will put lambda equals to 1. So first equation, Roman 1 is the zeroth power term, then Roman 2 is the first power term, second power term, and so on and so on. So you can go on creating different order of terms, zeroth order, first order, second order, third order, and so on and so forth. Right? But we know at the same time that your lambda h dash term, this perturbation, if it is small, then first order term, when multiplies to another first order term, it will be further small. If it is further multiplied, it is even very small. Therefore, what happens? That this series, zeroth order term, first order term, second order term, those series will slowly becoming zero. So it is converging series. So the basic idea of that Rayleigh-Schrodinger theory is that higher order terms are progressively smaller and smaller, and therefore you do not actually, in practice, you do not require to go beyond second order term. So these are the three equations which are the building blocks, or you can say the pillars of this Rayleigh-Schrodinger equations. We try to solve these equations in a stepwise way. First, we solve the zeroth order term, then first order term, and then second order term. Okay? Three different order equations in perturbation theory. Right? First is known as zeroth order term, zeroth order perturbation theory. This equation, second equation, is known as the first order perturbation theory. The last equation is known as the second order perturbation theory. So let us first solve the zeroth order perturbation theory. Let me just go back and hurriedly we can see this is something like H0 V0 is equals to W0 V0. That is what I have written again. And if you just go back to the very first slide where we have already said that your H0, which is a exactly solvable Hamiltonian, UN are the corresponding eigenstate function and En are the eigenvalues of this. This equation is very much similar to what we have already written. Instead of V0, we have said it is a UN. Instead of W0, we have said En. And this everything, UN is known, En is known. So can I say that by comparing this two equation, we can say that your W0 is something like En. En means one of the eigenvalue, not necessarily En only. It can be anything, but it is the eigenvalue of your H0. So this W0, the zeroth order term for W, is nothing but the eigenvalue of H0. So this Em is the eigenvalue of H0, which is already known to us. Because we know everything about this H0, we know everything about the corresponding eigenstate function UN, and we know everything about the different eigenvalues EN. So this W0 is nothing but one of the eigenvalue of H0, which I may call as EM. Similarly, I can say that if V0 is something like UN, then this V0, the state V0, will also be the eigenstate of H0, which is also known. So both W0 and V0 are already known. W0 is the eigenvalue, where V0 is one of the eigenstate of H0. But now we have two possibilities that we should we must look to it. V0, which is the eigenstate of Hamiltonian H0, can also be having two possibilities. Whether this V0 is non-degenerate or whether this V0 is degenerate. If it is non-degenerate, then we know that for non-degenerate states, corresponding to each and every eigenvalue, there exists only one eigenfunction or eigenstate. So if W0 is the eigenvalue EM, then corresponding to this eigenvalue, there exists only one eigenstate, which I may call as UM. Right? So this V0 can be written uniquely only in a one way as UM. But if this state V0 is degenerate state, let us assume that there are R-fold degeneracy. And you know that, what do you mean by degeneracy? That you may have different states, eigenstates, but all of them are having the same eigenvalue. So if your V0 is a degenerate states, then eigenvalue may be EM, but states are different, like UM1, UM2, UMR. If there are R number of such states, all of them are giving the energy EM, then you say that all R number of states are degenerate, or the amount of degeneracy you call as a R fold degeneracy. So if there are R states, all of them giving the same energy EM, then your H0 when operates on UM1, still your energy is EM. If H0 operates on UM2, still you get the eigenvalue EM. Likewise, you do it for R, then we can write now our state V0 as a linear combination of all such R states, which I write here as a UM alpha, where alpha will go from 1 to R. And of course, since you are writing the linear combination, this coefficient of this different terms I have written as A alpha. So I can just go on putting the value of alpha as 1, 2, 3. You can see it is the linear combination of this UM1, UM2, UMR. In fact, this A alpha, the coefficient, actually determines the weight factor for different states. It is possible that the state number 1, UM1, is contributing larger. Say 70% is UM1, which is contributing. UM2 is contributing only 10%, UMR is contributing only 3%, like that. Then correspondingly, this A alpha determines the coefficient for UM1 as a 0.7, because it is a contribution 70%, UM2 which contributes 10%, then A alpha will be like 0.1 and so on and so forth. So basically, this coefficients of this linear combination determines the weight factor of the different states. But we do have two possibilities. That V0 can be written as the non-degenerate case, or V0 can also be the degenerate. If it is degenerate, then using all those degenerate states, my final V0 can be written as the linear combination. But if it is non-degenerate, then there is only one state corresponding to one energy eigenvalue EM. So there is no need to write such linear combination. It can be written uniquely in terms of EM. So what this says, if we restrict as a first example, if we restrict only to the non-degenerate state, then for a non-degenerate state, this V0 can be written as a UM, only one possibility, there is no need for linear combination. So now I am applying this Rayleigh-Schrodinger theory for a non-degenerate case, and for a non-degenerate case, there is only one state, V0 is written as UM. So you can see here, this V0 is written as UM, and this W0 can be written as eigenvalue E. So this is what we have written for the zeroth order term. And don't forget that UN or UM or any U state, which are the eigenstate of this Hamiltonian H0, are known. Any energy eigenvalue of H0, that is EN, EM, EK, whatever you name it, they are already known. So definitely I can say that in this equation, the first equation, your UM is known to me, EM is known to me, means can I say that this problem is solved? The zeroth order problem is already solved, because I know everything about eigenstate, I know everything about the eigenvalue. Using this zeroth order state, now I want to go for solving the first order state. So I go back to my first order equation. You can see here equation number 2, H0 V1 H dash V0 is equals to W0 V1 plus W1 V0. Okay? So this equation I want to solve. If I go with the second order, the first order equation here. Only thing is that here this one term and this one term, the blue line I try to combine on left side, and this red wavy line I try to keep it on the right hand side. So I'm just making a group. That group, you can see here, this H0, W0 and V1. So this V1 I have kept on left side. Everything with V0 I have written on the right hand side. The problem is here that I don't know what is W1 here. I don't know what is V1 here also. Ready? So in the one equation, I have two unknowns, and therefore I need to write now, I need to employ some technique. I need to solve this problem with some special method. What is proposed by Rayleigh and Schrodinger? That this V1, that is known as the first order term for the eigenstate function V, this first order term V1, we can expand in terms of the basis un. And again, if you just recollect, in the very beginning I have mentioned that this h0 un equals to en un, then this un eigenstates are forming the complete orthonormal set, and therefore they can be used as a basis. So I have with me this un states, I have with me this un as a basis. So in terms of this un as a basis, now I can expand my V1 state, the first order term to state V, that I expand in terms of un. That is what I have written here. Correct? So this V1 is now expanded in terms of un with some coefficients, but these coefficients are taken as a first order value. First order value means their values are relatively small, and because of that, now overall term which we will calculate will also be of the first order. So basically, this first order correction to the state function V can be written in terms of this first order coefficient C, and the basis or the eigen state of unperturbed Hamiltonian H0. So this is what I expand. This is what I can write. And then, so in the next step, what I will do, instead of this V1, here in the second equation, instead of this V1, I will use this expansion. This V1 I can substitute here, and then from the left side I can take the scalar product with UK. UK means some eigencat of H0, but I write as a scalar product, so I write as a Bray UK, and then I take the scalar product from left. So this is what I can write. And see here, this left side UK will come, and then I open up this bracket. So H0 V1 one term, and this W0 V1 I write as a separate term. So if I open up this bracket, UK which multiplies from left, it's a scalar product. H0, instead of this V1, now I can use this expansion part. So that is what I have written. Second term with the W0, but don't forget W0 is nothing but your EM. So that I can write on right side, W1 and this H there. So simply I have taken a scalar product from left by UK. And then it's just playing with this equation, this sigma term, sigma sign, and this coefficients that I can write in front. So in the first term, you can see the first term here, the first term sigma and cn1 I can write in front. H0 will operate on un. I try to show with the broken this red line. So H0 operates on un. This part I can take before this. Em is the eigenvalue, it's just the number, so I can write in front. The sigma and cn1 I can write in front. So it is basically UK, un, all this being constant, I can write outside. W1, which is also the eigenvalue, so it is just a number, so I can write it outside. Similarly, this um, which is nothing but your V0, all this substitution when I do, I have the next equation where sigma cn1 en, because H0 when operates on un, H0, as in the first line I have mentioned that H0 operates on um, it gives em um. Similarly, here, when H0 operates on UN, then it is EN UN that I get. And finally, what you have is this UK and this UN get multiplied. So we have this delta, Kronecker delta property here, here, and but don't be in hurry because there is H dash, but we don't know what is the H dash right now. So H dash will remain as it is. It is basically the matrix element, or you can say it is the UK H dash UM. And what we have done in the unit number one, this quantity we can write as a H dash KM. Just to abbreviate, just to make a small symbol, I can write as a H dash KM. So this is my final equation, that's it. And then I have two choices, K equals to N, that is on left side, whereas on the right hand side, we have K equals to M. So I start with this right side term. So if your K equals to M, but not N, If k is not equals to n, obviously both the terms on left hand side will be zero because the Kronecker delta will be zero. Whereas on the right hand side, when k equals to m, this uk um will be one, and you are left with only w one, and this term h dash km that will be as it is. But only difference is that instead of m, now you can write k also, so it is like h dash kk. Either you write kk or mm, same, because k equals to m. So what you get is the value of w1. Don't forget, w1 means it is the correction of energy eigenvalue for up to first order. It's w1 is the energy correction up to first order, and that you get as h dash mm. When I write this fully, it is like um h dash um, and you know that this is like a expectation value. Just recollect what we have done in the unit number one. This is the expectation value of operator h dash. So the first order correction to energy eigenvalue is nothing but the expectation value of this operator h dash for eigenstate um. And don't forget, this um are the eigenstate of h0, which is already known. So I can definitely make this calculation. Only this integration um h dash um that I have to perform, that will give me the value of w1. W1 means first order correction to energy. So w1 is now ready. So in this equation, you can see this w1, which was a question mark, that I now calculate. Second question is about v1, and for that I go further and I take now different second possibility. K equals to n instead of m, now I take k equals to n but not m. So this delta km term, that will be zero. Both left side Kronecker delta will be one. So if I write them combinedly, out of this many different choices of n, only one choice will survive. Whenever your n equals to k, that term will survive. So instead of n, we have now ck. Instead of en, now we have ek. Of course, this em will be as it is, so we have this term. Whereas on the right hand side, where h dash km, but now k is written as n, so we have either you write k or whether you write n, so you have this equation, and from that you can now make your ck1 subject. That's what I have done. So ck1 will be ready, which is written as h dash km upon ek minus em. I just take this bracket on a right hand side, so what I have is ck1 is ready. Right, so now I have w1 ready, which is your h dash mm. It is nothing but the expectation value. And for v1, if I just go back to my expression for v1, you can see this is the v1. This is my v1. In this v1, I have now obtained the value of cn1. U1 is already known because they are the eigenstates of the unperturbed part. So this is already known. So only question was to how to find cn1. That I have obtained. So my v1 is also ready. This cn1, now I can write using this information. So it is h dash nm upon en minus em. Instead of k, because here summation is with n, so I am, instead of n k value, I am writing with n. So this is h dash nm upon en minus em. Only thing is to be noticed here, that on a sigma sign I have also put a prime, which indicates that you are not allowed to take n equals to m. Otherwise, what happens? You can see here in the denominator, if n and m are equal, it will make this v1 infinite. Right? So we are not selecting n and m equal. So this is indicating, this prime indicates that n and m value are not equal. And in fact, there is no need to consider also, because though I have not shown completely, it is written in the textbook that if you take k equals to n, correct, this n and m if are equal, then also you can prove that correspondingly, instead of ck, if you write cm coefficient, instead of n, if you write m, then instead of this cn, if you have cm1, that comes zero. So automatically the coefficient corresponding to m value comes out to be zero, and therefore there is no need to write it. And therefore this prime, which takes care of this divergence value of v1, is in fact not required because corresponding coefficient is zero. Correct? So V1 we can expand, we can write with all values of n, but not m. M will not be allowed, and then you can write the different values of n. So we have W1 ready, we have V1 ready. So this is known as the first order correction to energy eigenvalue W. This is known as the first order correction to the eigenstate P. So with this idea, when I go back to my original equation for the total W and total V, see this equation and this last two equations which I have written for the power series expansion of W and V, and if I go for n equals to 0, that is 0th term, n equals to 1, that is the first order term, then my correction to this W, this total W, when I write n equals to 0 plus n equals to 1, so if I take only the first order term, up to first order term, then this W0 I can write as EM. For W1 we have already written it is like a matrix element or expectation value, so it is H dash MM. And for V also, when I do this, for V0 I can write UN, for V1 also I can write like UN, so UN, UN I can keep common, then I have this square bracket as a pre-multiplying factor to this UN. So this is what I get. Okay, that's it. This is my last slide. What it indicates then? Once you apply the perturbation H dash, you can see this first equation. This is the interesting physics here. Once you apply this H dash, original energy, unperturbed energy, EM, now has some contribution from H dash. So there is a change in energy. Your energy is no longer EM, but it is now changing to H by amount H dash, MM. And therefore, can I say that instead of original energy level, your energy levels are actually shifting. They are changing their values. This H dash MM can be plus, it can be minus also. If it is plus, then EM plus something, so your energy will be lifted up. If H dash term contributes negative, then your energy will be lower. So there is a lowering or the raising of the energy that takes place because of H dash. Your energy levels are no longer at EM value, they are now shifted. So there is a shifting of energy that we can understand. Similarly, if your H dash is not present, if your perturbation is not there, then even in this equation, the last equation also, this term involving H dash, that will be zero. And you can see this one multiplied by UN means your original eigenstate will be there. But now because of the perturbation, your eigenstate function UN has now different amplitude. Let us assume that the sigma dash and all this term has a contribution 0.1. Then it is 1 minus 0.1 means basically it is 0.9. So your UN is now only 90% of its original value. So you can see there is a change in the magnitude, there is a change in the amplitude of this state function. So what is the role of this perturbation? What perturbation has done here? One, perturbation has shifted the energy, equation number one. It can raise the energy or it can lower the energy. And secondly, about the state function UN, now what happens? Its amplitude or magnitude will also be changed. It can be enhanced, it can lower the value of state function, or it can enhance. So this shifting of the energy state, shifting of the energy eigenvalue, that is being done by the effect of perturbation. So the role of perturbation is to shift, to change the energy levels. And how this shifting of the energy levels is actually helpful to experimental physicists, how they can use this idea to understand the different energy levels when, say, a hydrogen atom is exposed to electric field, or when the magnetic material is kept in presence of external magnetic field. All those ideas, all those concepts we can easily understand by this theory. But this is only up to the first order. So as a topic, we can say that we have solved the Rayleigh-Schrodinger perturbation theory up to the first order, and we have calculated the first order correction to the energy, and also we have calculated the first order correction to the state function. same way we will go next time for the second order. I think mathematics will be same, idea will be the same. Only thing is that now we will get some more idea, more understanding about the different orders of perturbation and what is the role of perturbation that we try to understand. So next time on Tuesday, with this, at the same time we go with the second order perturbation theory. So this is all about the first order perturbation theory for discrete energy levels, time independent nature of the problem that we have derived today. So if you have any questions, if you have any doubts, you can ask me. But meanwhile, let me just switch off my recording so that you can freely ask the questions. So I just stop recording. Okay, so recording has been now stopped.